HarperCollins presents Fray by Chris Carse Wilson. Read by Angus King. For Elaine and Neve. For everything. Sometimes all you can do is climb the peak of the nearest mountain and scream at the top of your voice. Devil. 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 That might buy you some more time to run. This was the first note I read, not long after discovering the cottage he'd been hiding in for nearly a year. Or perhaps not hiding, but certainly hidden. Dad disappeared shortly after Mum died, shortly after I drove him away. He took her death badly, but not in the usual sense. Dad didn't believe in the truth of it. He thought she was elsewhere. Not gone, but discoverable. He thought she was there to be found. And I found, eventually, this near derelict abandoned cottage, hidden in the forests and mountains of northern Scotland. Somewhere they used to go before I was born, but somewhere we never went as a family. A special place, but a hidden place, even then. Inside was a sea of writing, spread over every surface. Crude hand-drawn maps and ripped pieces of paper thrown everywhere. A giant jigsaw tipped out of its box. She is near, and I can feel it. I've started to seriously explore now. To begin my search. There are layers here, fogs and clouds, sharp blades of light. Somewhere in there she is trapped. There are endless miles and mountains, and in every weather they change. She may be here, but not here. She may move with the light. The police said no one owned the cottage. And it isn't marked on any maps. Deep inside a forest, hours and miles from anyone or anywhere, long since forgotten. A squat pile of stones holding a simple roof over one solitary room. An empty fireplace, an old table and chair, a camp bed frame with no sleeping bag, and nothing else apart from all the paper. A smell of stale, still air inside, and heady pine resin outside. Some water had come down the chimney and under the door, but surprisingly little for the extremes of weather that cascade through these mountains. Not quite a house, rather a shrine lost in a forest. To start with, no one was sure where he was. Mum's funeral came and went. The rush of shared grief and strangers passed. And a few days later he went too, after our heated, burning words. My words. Quietly. Coldly. With just a mountaineering bag and some basic outdoor clothing. He left. With a pair each of worn-out hiking boots and running trainers. He left. I thought he would return within a few hours, maybe a day or two. No note, no calls, nothing but dead silence. When it became clear he had really gone, I tried to look. I tried to find help. Bulky policemen sat awkwardly in my parents' front room, scratching into comically small notepads. They wore belts holding the tools of crime and capture, handcuffs and radios and more. Tools that were meaningless to me. I assumed he had run to the Lake District, somewhere we had gone often as a family, a place of escape and adventure, of walking and sunshine and family warmth, of wood smoke carried on the frozen air. I looked south, and he ran north. It took me a while to catch up. cover ground once is not enough. To cover ground during day and night and every weather is essential. But someone else is searching too. I must hurry. It took almost 9 months to find where he had gone. Months of grieving, fractured and doubled, certainty clouded and confused. Through a winter, spring, summer and back to autumn again, sifting through their home with its new weight and sorrow, not knowing what to keep and what to throw away. How do you pack up and move on from a death and a disappearance? When does a silence become permanent, become sure? I stopped and started, stopped and started. I drove to the Lake District and tracked old holiday homes, walked winding streets, watched the villages and fells swell with warm weather visitors, then recede again. A great migration, but still nothing. I tore through their cupboards and drawers, looking for anything that might suggest, that might explain. I turned over and over those final words, that guilt and weakness, the hot anger that pushed him away, pushed him too far. The strength of words and their failure. Finally, I came to a beaten cardboard box of old photograph albums, hiding under a pile of dusty curtains in the attic. Something from their early days, perhaps even their honeymoon. Yellowing images of hillsides, of views from peaks, and a pile of battered hillwalkers' maps, frayed along their folding lines, creases that spoke of rain and drying, of repeated opening and closing in the wet and the wind. Photograph of Mum, glowing, standing outside a tiny cottage, slightly blurred as she turns to the camera, mid-laugh. She is surrounded by towering pines, stretching far above her. And on one map, there was a single, simple dot. A mark to suggest the centre of everything. Somewhere you might run in anger, in pain, to discover and remember. Or to pretend that nothing has happened. Today I came upon the grand disused hotel, boarded up and rain-beaten, collapsed and resigned high in a hill. Once it thrived with wealthy patrons looking to walk the land and destroy what they disturbed, to imagine Scotland, to play in pantomime tweed and drink and shoot and kill. Driving to the wilderness was both calm and crazed. A beautiful and manic trip through rolling countryside, feeling the land change as you climb higher, as hills grow to mountains, as nature becomes bigger and fiercer everywhere you look. I was driving towards a dot, towards an old photograph that told me nothing, chasing a desperate hope. If not there, then where? I had scoured, searched, trailed everywhere else I could think of. I had nothing left to give and nowhere left to go. It was close to impossible to find. A place to hide, miles and miles from anywhere, completely invisible from both inside and outside the forest, covered by a whispering canopy of evergreen needles. I slowly drove along the rough, rutted track, fearing that my car would get stuck. I crawled over the bridged river, along the trail until it faded, disappeared, until I had to pick my way between trees, avoiding stumps and roots, then deeper and deeper. And then I arrived. It was the photo from the attic, but with no one to be seen. No smiling younger mum. No dad taking the picture, his back to the sunshine spilling through the trees. The forest was alive again, no longer faded and yellowed. I found hope. After months of searching, after hours of driving, exhausted, always exhausted. Hope that lasted just long enough to run from the car, burst through the cottage door, expecting to find him sitting there, expecting tears and reunion and apologies, only to be met with paper piled upon paper. Inside me, something tore further still. Walking around, the outside matched the photograph, but didn't. My eyes flitted from the faded colours to the uneven brightness of the wilderness. She looked so happy then, freckled, hair and sunshine almost merging into one, lean and athletic from years of movement, not thin and frail from death's sudden pull. The cottage looked barely changed, bar a carpet of moss silently creeping over its roof. I looked around. I listened. No one could find this by accident. Perhaps that was the point. At the hotel's front door, where bags would have been taken and sirs and ma'ams swapped for, small handfuls of dirty coins, a lone CCTV camera stared. A metal box, fixed, unmoving, with a red eye looking for unwanted arrivals. And at the other end, someone watching over. Or just an empty dummy with a light to scare away bored teenagers flirting with trouble and fire. I stared at the light. A laser pointing, accusing. I stared at the light and felt her trapped somewhere on the other side. Somewhere beyond, watching and waiting. Once I'd finally found it, I sat inside the cottage, silent and stuck. I tried to count the number of pieces of paper and couldn't. The weight of the heart was too heavy. But my guess would be a few thousand sheets and scraps. I counted a little over 200 pages before it all became too much, before sinking to the floor as if weakened by thin air. Standing on the top of Everest, gasping, grasping for breath, while sitting on a cold stone floor in a glen in Scotland. There was no clear order to the pieces, nothing obviously connecting one to another, no dates or clues. Most were words calmly placed on the page, but still words that were rushing to escape. Some were sketches of mountainsides and peaks. A few were very basic maps, which seemed to link together some of the sketches. All was totally baffling, and perhaps still is. I stayed, but never slept there. I couldn't. Too cold, too dark, too much noise roaming the forest outside, whistling through the warped window frames, roaring down the chimney. I stayed and wrote. Wrote letters to Dad. Wrote for the sake of writing. But always asking questions. Pleading and reaching out. That was my grieving. My paper prayers for two lost parents. I had no idea what I would find next. Today the weather changed. Brightness drowned. The devil is here now. Dawn. 1. This is the start. Day 1. He must be here. There must be more than all those notes and this confused nonsense about a devil. I will stay for a week. Find something. Anything. Tell the police. Help them find him. Then move on. Bring everything back home. Everything, if not everyone. The paper is still spread out, as I am not yet ready to move it. I can't. I tiptoe around piles, glancing at the pages on top as I find a way from the door to the chair by the table. The door is thick and wooden, any paint long since darkened to the point of being.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.